she completed her PhD in 2004 from the University of California at San Diego. Her interests are mainly in solving problems related to networking. Next, we have Jyoti Bhat. Jyoti has 18 years of industry experience in software delivery, research, product management, and process control. Jyoti has now switched to academics and is pursuing a doctorate from IIM Bangalore in information systems. Till recently, she was a principal research scientist leading business process management research group within Infosys Labs.
Hi.
We also have Maya Ramnath. Maya Ramnath is an assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at IIT Delhi. Previously, she was a researcher at Max Planck Institute of Informatics, Germany for more than 5 years. She graduated from the Indian Institute of Science in 2006. Her research interests are in the area of database and information retrieval techniques for semantic web data management.
Hello. Hi.
So, I'll start off with Maya and Ranjita. So, what is your opinion on research, and is it just limited to papers and conferences? And how did you go about with your PhD?
Okay, I guess in an abstract sense, you can consider research to be the search for knowledge. But being a little more practical than that, it involves identifying a problem, solving it in a systematic manner. The word systematic is important. And communicating your, you know, solution to the world. So that's what I regard research as. And there's this part about communicating to the world. One of the ways you do that is publications. And especially if you're in academia, one of the ways in which your research output is measured is through publications. What kind of conferences you have published your papers in, things like that. But Ranjita is from an industrial lab. She has a different perspective as well on this.
Yeah, so I work for Microsoft Research, and it's called Microsoft Research because one of the main things that we do is, in a bottom-up way, try and come up with new ideas to computer science, information technology, and see how we can improve the state of the art. So I would say that paper publication is definitely one of our main goals as part of Microsoft Research, because that is a way for making sure that people in the community recognize your work. And it's very important to have experts in your community of networking systems, databases, whatever it is, appreciate your work and recognize it. So that being said, one of the other focuses for us as a company, as a research lab in a company, is also to see how our research can make our products better. So towards that, we talk to our product groups who are very receptive to meeting researchers and see how we can transfer our ideas into making products for Microsoft better. So it's not just paper publication, I would say. Real world impact is as important, if not more important.
I guess the second part of your question was, how did we get to do PhD? So I have been studying for the first 30 years of my life because I just went directly from my bachelor's to master's to PhD. And I don't think I had a very specific plan to do PhD. It just seemed to be the natural next step. I had all the encouragement from my parents to do this. So it just seemed to be the natural thing for me to do. So there's no specific calculation behind doing PhD, at least from my perspective, yeah.
So for me too, I can go into some history here. But before that, I'd just like to understand how much of this audience is our students. Can the students please raise their hands? Okay, all right, thanks. So, after I finished my undergrad degree, everybody else was applying to grad school abroad. So I said, I should also apply to grad school abroad. And so I did that, I got an admission and a scholarship, and that's why I went. But then once I was there, I had the option of dropping out of after a master's, because my advisors had started a company and he had no time for his grad students. So I thought, you know, I should drop out after a master's. But then I said, no, let me try another advisor. So I switched advisors. And then 1 week after I switched advisors, the new advisor also went and started a company. So again, I was left high and dry, and I thought, you know, this is a sign from above. I have to quit after a master's. But I don't know what it was. I just stuck on. I think it was I really, really got interested in technical problems at that point because I spent all my time reading papers because there was no advisor to tell me what to do. I just read research papers. I got interested in a bunch of problems. And then I went to a third guy and I said, you know, can you be my advisor? I want to work on this problem. And he said, yeah, sure. And then it just worked out. So that's how I went about getting my PhD. So initially it was entirely, you know, follow the mob, do whatever the mob does. But after that, I think I just got interested in computer science and research in general.
Okay. So Jyoti, after about 2 decades in the industry, what prompted you to get back to academia?
For the last 6 to 7 years, I've been with Infosys Labs, which is the R&D group for Infosys Technologies. So the type of work which I was doing there was research, though it would be applied research, like what she said, that it would be related to the problems which Infosys has or its clients has. So looking at what outputs which come out of these Infosys labs has to be relevant to Infosys services and products. But again, papers and patents are the goals on which you are measured. So I've been in this field for the last 6-7 years, and I reached a stage where I felt that I didn't get the type of guidance and mentorship inside Infosys, because my boss was more a managerial type of person, and my colleagues were all they were my peers, and they had more computer science PhDs. I mean, we have an ex-UC Berkeley prof also in Infosys Labs. But my interest area is business process management, information systems management, and those type of things. So that's why I thought the next thing would be like get someone who can mentor me on the management science side of IT. And though I don't tell this publicly, let me just tell it. IIM Bangalore is just next door to my house. So. So I just applied and they selected me, and I just went and told my boss that 10 days I have to join IIM Bangalore, so I'm resigning. So that's how I got into it. It was not like a planned out type of thing. The other thing was I had decided I'll retire when I'm 40. I have a 2-year-old second child. So this is a way of spending time with him and also doing what I like.
So you're doing a management PhD.
Yes.
So how is that different from
that? Oh, that will be vastly different from doing a computer science or an E type of PhD. It's a totally different thing. The first thing my prof told me when he was interviewing me for the position was that this is not IT. You will not see a single line of code being written or even a single server anywhere. So you should recognize that first. So the type of subjects you will be learning is what CEOs would be more interested in. It is economics, strategy, financial accounting, corporate finance, those type of things, along with information systems, like information system strategy, IT governance. The type of things which we hear in computer science and also in organizations, but this is just so that you know how IT fits into an organization strategy. And that is why I am doing it in IIM Bangalore. Or in a management school, basically.
So how do you guys maintain work-life balance?
Okay, so I'm married with 2 kids, the 2 daughters, and they're great, and they help me maintain this work-life balance, if I indeed do. I think those of you who are still yet to get married, I would suggest you get married to the right guy who doesn't mind working in the kitchen, doing the household work, and those that have been traditionally, you know, women's jobs. So my husband and I have perfect understanding about these things. There is no task that we won't do. We can both equally manage the house well, whether it's cooking and cleaning, changing diapers, or even calling electricians, fixing the car, things like that. So it's 50-50. And then I would advise you to train your kids really well, because one of the real stress points I find is, you know, taking care of kids, it's really hard. So the better you train them, the less the stress that you have. So that's what I find. And the other thing that both my husband and I follow very religiously is time management. We never schedule any meetings or any professional things for outside of work hours and never in holidays or weekends. So that's the time for our family. We strictly follow it. The only exception to this is conference travel, where one of us might have to go away for a week. But we say it's always work while you work. So it's always a 9-to-5 schedule. And then after the kids go to sleep, we may work extra. But when our kids are with us, we are always like, okay, no technical things or work-related things are to be done. So I hope that will lead me to work-life balance, but I'm not sure yet.
Just to add to that, I would say that initially I was thinking that I would get a better work-life balance with doing a PhD program. So I just don't want to belittle a PhD program, saying that it doesn't involve a lot of effort. It actually involves a lot more effort. When I was in Infosys, I could just say 9-to-5. Outside office, I'm not picking up the call, and I actually switch off the BlackBerry. I don't even check the mail. But here, since it is my interest area, and I have an ego saying I can't take low grades on my quizzes, so though everyone says it's okay, it's an ego issue. So that's there. But like how Maya said, I think the person you get married to also makes a big difference. My husband wants me to do a PhD. He's actually a freelancer. He quit his job about 5 years back so that he could be with his child. I had only one at that time. Now I have two, so he takes care of both of them. When I am in school, but once I come back, I take care of them for a couple of hours. And then once they go to sleep, that's when I sit and do my papers or reading and writing. The other thing is your support system at home. I have an army of maids at home, one to take care of the kitchen, one to take care of the house, and one to take care of the garden, and one just in case one of them doesn't come. So, and there are times when all four of them don't come, so that's also possible. But I think you should build all these into your planning before you even get into the idea of doing a PhD after getting married. Before getting married, do only a PhD, don't do anything else. There are people, like I have a colleague of mine who is doing her PhD in IIT Bombay. She just finished her 1 year coursework. She works with Infosys Labs. So she has two kids. She's going to do a part-time PhD and also going to work at Infosys. I'll just have to meet her next year and figure out how her work life and student life is.
So let me answer the question slightly differently. So when you're a researcher, one of the requirements of you, from yourself and also from the organization around you, is to come up with new ideas. And coming up with new ideas is not a process that naturally comes to you 9-to-5. So very often, I get up early, I wake up around 5:30 every morning, and I'm like, why can't I do this in that project? And then I have to consciously make the effort to block that out, because my mornings are for something else I do. I sing every morning, I practice my music. So I have to block that out, I have to do my music, then I have to have my breakfast and then head to work and then train myself to think about my research and try and come up with ideas in that time frame. And it's a battle for me. Because it's easier said than done, but it's something that we need to zoom out and we need to do continuously. Every time we're thinking of something which we're not supposed to be thinking at a certain point, we have to put a stop there and then just think about that when we have scheduled time for it. And that is irrespective of, you know, if you're married, if you have kids, it's something we all need to do personally.
Both of you have done your PhD abroad and you
I'm in India.
So how do you think it's different here and abroad?
Okay, I think there are several differences between doing a PhD here and abroad. And I think people really have to think about what they want to achieve after the PhD before they decide whether to do a PhD in India or in the US. Abroad means US, I assume here. So I think the best research is still being done in the US, and I'm talking about the top universities there. So the best research is still being done there. and the best people, and there are lots of these really top people, they're still in the US. So I think the chances of you meeting them, working with them, is higher if you're on location, that is, you do your PhD in the US. And the other big advantage, I think, to doing your PhD in the US is that the departments that you work in, they generally have a lot of students, so you have a lot of peers. So your network of contacts is a lot bigger, and this really helps you out when you are looking for jobs, especially after your PhD. So the third thing is regarding funding. So I tend to think, again, this is with the top universities in the US I'm talking about. Advisors usually have enough funding to support their students for conference travel, which is usually not the case, sometimes not the case in India. So in India, people encourage you to publish in journals because there's simply no money to travel to an international conference. So, and I think, I happen to think for computer science, at least conference travel is a really important thing, but you need to have the money to do that. So if you're in the US, very likely your advisor can take care of you. So it's just about being in a place where there's excellent research going on, you meet lots of people, you develop your network, and the chances that you do great stuff is higher if you're in the US. That's my take on it.
I would just like to add a slightly different twist to this. Abroad, like Maya said, not necessarily be only US. You can even look at Europe and Australia, depending on your specific area of interest. That the research methodology itself is different in Europe compared to the way it is done in the US. And the type of problems they work on is different from the problems they work on in the United States. And I'm talking about computer science itself. And if you move into other areas, it is totally different. And why I'm mentioning that is because in Europe, the mindset itself is like they're trying to solve general problems of public. In US, it is more funded by a corporation. So it would be influenced by what comes from the corporations. I mean, how your professor gets his funding done. So there is a slight difference over there. It's just that since India, because of its IT industry and offshoring business, we know more about what's happening in the US and the professors and the universities over there than what's happening in the European countries or even in Australia. Why I mention that is because when I was in Infosys, we had collaborations with universities in UK, Netherlands, and in Australia, and also obviously in the US, and I didn't find any difference in the type of work or the quality of work being done across these. It's just that the topics were totally different. So you can actually look at other countries. The problem with Europe would be language. That's the only thing. You will have to learn, you will not be able to understand the local language if you go outside the UK, that is.
So I'd like to disagree a little with Jyoti there, that in the US, a lot of research is actually funded by the National Science Foundation and the defense agency, DARPA, especially in computer science. In fields, so DARPA tends to sponsor things which have military help, but essentially they're all blue sky. So you could be doing distributed systems and network routing algorithms and still be funded by DARPA. So just a small disagreement, though there is also corporate funding in the US. Going back to the original question of doing a PhD in the US versus India, I completely agree with what Maya said, in the sense that the US is known to be a center of research right now, academic research, because they have a great education system. I don't know how many of you attended the keynote today, but that was one point that the keynote speaker raised. And I might be politically incorrect in saying this, but if you have an opportunity, then I think it's the best thing is to go to a great school in the US. Having said that, trying to do a PhD in India also has its advantages, because there you're a cog in the wheel. You're one of, you know, umpteen PhD students. Whereas if you're really good and you're a PhD student in India, you have the opportunity to really, really shine. Because right now the market, the pool of PhD students in India is very small. So that's another advantage of doing your PhD here.
Just to add to that, I'm looking for really good PhD students. So if you're interested in my areas, please come and talk to me later. I guess choosing the area of interest is, don't overthink it. Probably use your master's degree time to do explore lots of different courses. And then finally, you have a pretty long project time, like a 1 year project you have to do. So choose something that you feel good about, that you're good in. It makes the progress easier. And that's how you kind of get into it. And once you're into a PhD program, I think, the options are a little bit flexible. So you say you're a databases person, but there are a million different things that you can do in databases. So I guess you just use your master's time to kind of explore all kinds of different areas and then try to focus on one. That's what I would say.
So another thing I would like to add is, depending on your interest, you should pick the top conferences that publish papers in that field, and just take a look through them. I'm not saying you need to read every paper word by word, but you get a sense of what people are working on by looking at these top conferences. So, I mean, you can come talk to us later about what your interests are, and we could potentially help you find those top conferences if you don't already know. But that's the way I went about it when I was a grad student, and that's the way I still do it, because every few years we say, you know, this is passé, so we should try and find some other thing to do. And this is what we do. We attend conferences because we have money, so we can do that. Otherwise, we read the papers of the conferences that we can't attend.
Yeah, and just to add to that, like Maya said, you shouldn't overthink it, because once you're a researcher, you will obviously diversify, move into other areas, like Ranjita just said, that especially in computer science, things move very fast. So what you should be looking for in a PhD program is, one is your area of interest, at least a broad area, and you learn all the basics of how to do research, build your network, how to read papers. The way you read papers actually matters, and how to write papers.
I guess the second part was regarding how to do a part-time PhD. I would not recommend it.
I second that.
Yeah, I mean, if you need to achieve excellence in anything, there needs to be focus and dedication. And PhD is not something that you do on the side. It requires your full focus. So I do not recommend doing a part-time PhD.
Though I did agree with them just a few minutes back, but if you are interested in doing a part-time, assuming you have to do and there is no other option, the best would be if your job also entails doing research. If you are in a delivery project where you have deadlines, customer-driven deadlines, and you want to do a PhD, that will be like poles apart. But if you join some research lab, and they usually fund your PhD also, because they then tie up and your PhD thesis will be something of interest to that organization. Then a PhD may work out. And about doing it here in India, or should you go look for a job in the US and then do a part-time there, I think that's taking a too long chance, saying that you'll just go there and then get a PhD. What if you don't get funding and all that? So if you are already here, want to do a part-time here, you should explore options here, but then location becomes a big factor over there. You'll have to consider there that, based on my knowledge of at least what I know from IBM and Infosys Labs, they do support PhDs in certain universities and all, like IIIT, Hyderabad, Bangalore, IITs, all the, I don't think with IIT Delhi, but the other IITs. IIT Delhi doesn't allow a part-time PhD. That's why.
I do.
Maybe so Maya convinced them not to.
No, because the university should agree for a part-time PhD. That's the key. I mentioned about location. The gate of Infosys and the gate of IIIT Bangalore are just 10 feet apart. So.
Yeah, so people just keep coming back and forth between college. Hi, my name is Krisha. I'm a PhD student at North Carolina State.
I'm a PhD student at North Carolina State University. So. I agree completely with you that, you know, in the US it's much easier to get a lot more exposure and go to a lot more, you know, many more conferences easily. So I actually have two questions. Firstly, you know, although I'm getting all that exposure, I would also like to find out about researchers in India. And I'm not staying in India right now. How can I do that? I mean, what's a good way to go about, you know, finding about, you know, who all are in my area and things like that? And my second question is regarding once I complete my PhD, I think I have about a year and a half left now. So once I complete, I would like to stay in the academia and, you know, teach and stuff. I like teaching. So, you know, where would you say is a better place to start off? Is it, again, you know, better to start off in the US and then move to India later? Or does India have, you know, do starters? I know that there are top professors here who have a lot of funding. But if I'm starting off, will I get enough grants? And will I, you know, will I be able to get that much exposure? Or is it harder here? So I'm really puzzled about that right now. So.
Okay, for the first part of your question, I would suggest attending Grace Hopper conferences in India. But I think for a job search, generally, there are quite a lot of websites that you can visit, even for the Indian setting. I mean, all the IITs, IIITs, companies, they all have job openings advertised on their website. So that is one starting point. But the best method is to develop contacts in these companies to let you know when there is an opening coming up. So I think attending conferences like this, you know, saying that, hey, here I am, I'm a potential candidate from next year, maybe I can come give a talk, things like that. I think developing your network is one of the powerful ways in which you can get to know about these openings, which are not necessarily advertised on the website. So that's first part.
So are you just talking about academic jobs in India or? Okay, so the only thing I would like to add to what Maya said was there's a Yahoo group which used to be pretty active called RRI, which I followed very religiously when I was in the US, when I was thinking of coming back. So researchers returning to India, it's called. So I would suggest you join that group and also just look through the archives because there's a lot of information in the archives which is useful for people who are doing research in the US and want to come back to or anywhere abroad and want to come back to India.
Just to add to that, there are India-specific conferences, IIIT-sponsored ones. So I would suggest you go through the program committee list on that. You will find the relevant professors and also industry researchers on the program committee over there or as reviewers. So you can actually get in touch with them because you'll know the area they are interested in because they'll be specifically in that type of conference and all that.
Okay, so the second part, I guess, academic jobs in India, if you're looking for IITs, I think most of the IITs provide you with initiation grant. I'm getting about 10 lakhs. That's kind of enough to just start off, okay? But the main source of funding is still remains the government. So you can write proposals to DST, DIT, and the defense DRDO up to the tune of 2 crores, 3 crores, whatever you want to, just start up your own lab. you can do this, and people have done it, I know of that. That said, there are also industries, software industry in India where they do support some amount of funding. Maybe Ranjita knows more about it. I'm still exploring this myself. So after a year or two, I can tell you whether there is enough funding for new guys in India.
I know for sure that Microsoft Research and also IBM Research in Bangalore, if anybody's from IBM Research here, so you can correct me if I'm wrong, but we have these grant programs where we provide a grant to faculty from Indian universities, and usually lasts a year, and we have a very loose tie-up, as in as long as the field of research is broadly related to what we are interested in at Microsoft, we are ready to fund people. And I'm sure, I think IBM also has something like that.
Please correct me if I'm wrong. So in the world of research, a lot of papers are getting piled up. We keep writing papers again and again. And sometimes I feel that as a researcher, you would have done a good job and probably it's satisfactory to you and you're happy. But it would just, you know, cause an epsilon or delta improvement to what was already there, and it would just pile up as an lot of more papers in some journal. So how do, and you might end up feeling that maybe if I were in an industry and if I were doing something else there, the impact of that would be higher. I don't know how satisfied I would still feel there, but maybe the impact would be higher there. So how do you come to terms with that, and how do you actually do research? Maybe we are capable of doing research that is causing more than delta improvement. Maybe we are not, but how do you, sort of take yourself in that direction so that your research actually causes more impact?
I guess it's hard to come to terms with the fact that you're really insignificant in the scale of things. Okay. In the beginning, when I started my PhD, I wanted to do something really great, impactful, the whole world would know. I kind of still want to do that, but I just realize how much more harder it is. So I think my philosophy is to look at myself as a cog in a huge wheel, the workings of which I don't know, and just to keep doing my best all the time, keep trying again and again, and at some point, things click together. Because if you don't try, you're not going to do anything, that's for sure. To take a smaller example, that this business of papers, my papers used to come back rejected, then I would be depressed because I spent months on it. But my advisor used to say, it's like, keep trying again, 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 again. Finally, you have to hit the dartboard at some point, right? So keep trying and keep putting your best effort all the time.
Yeah, I just got a paper rejected yesterday and I'm very depressed, really.
Just a cog in a wheel, don't worry about it.
I'd like to give a little slightly different view to that. I think you should redefine what you mean by world. You don't have to make an impact at a global level. You redefine your area, and I'm sure if, like how Maya said, you keep trying, you will make an impact on that, because by the time you would figure out if with so many rejections and just being an insignificant piece in that whole, your redefined world, you'll know what that world actually is looking for. And then you will be able to make an impact there. I don't think we'll all be Albert Einstein or something like that, at least in my lifetime. But
you should not give up hope, though.
Yeah. No, that's why I have redefined my world that I don't want to be over there. I'm looking at something else. So if I make an impact over there, that's enough.
So I would like to answer that. But before I answer the question, can I ask, are you a PhD student or...?
Yeah.
For 2 years.
Okay. I was primarily working on theoretical computer science. Okay. I had some papers and stuff. So then I decided to move to industry, and currently I'm with Amazon. And at the bottom of my heart, I always want to go back to research because I felt that's more interesting and that's more fun.
Right. So it also depends where you are in your career. So if you early on in your career, it makes sense to look at, you know, not world-changing problems and find an incremental solution, do a delta, get your papers in. Then at some point you run into midlife crisis and you say, you know, there's no point doing all this stuff I'm doing. Let me just throw it out and let me think of something bigger. And maybe you would be in a position at that point in time where you're senior in whatever organization you're in, or which will let you take that extra risk. So I think as young grad students, like they said earlier, don't try to overthink. But at the same time, try to keep the big picture in mind that, is this, you know, super delta, or is it still going to get into some of the top conferences? Are the top conferences still publishing papers on this topic? If other people think that it's a good area, then it makes sense to publish, because that's one of the main things you need to concentrate on as a young grad student or a young researcher, young academic.
Quick question. When I look through the university websites, there are programs that offer integrated PhDs, like MS PhD, and there are like programs direct PhDs. And if I'm looking for something like masters, and then work in the industry for a while, and then go for a PhD, of all the three things that I just said, which one do you think is the most?
Shall I take that?
Please.
Okay. It depends. It completely depends on you. So I have had colleagues, as I did my PhD and even now, who knew right from day one that I'm going to do a PhD. My parents are both professors, so I need to do a PhD. So if you have that in mind, you can apply for integrated PhD programs. And I did that too. But I did get admission in a school which had just PhD, no masters, but I didn't take it because I was not sure. So I left my options open and I took a slightly lower ranked school than the other one because I wanted the option of quitting after a master's. But after 2 years in a master's, I said, you know, I actually like this research stuff, so I stuck on. And then again, you know, I don't think you can plan right now. I'm assuming you're an undergrad, but I don't think you can plan, you know, I'll do my master's, then I'll go work, then I'll come back to a PhD.
Does it make you any better researcher?
Yeah, definitely it makes you better. You get, I mean, being more mature always helps in making these decisions.
Me? Okay. I actually don't have a master's. I did my engineering, got a campus recruit. The first company which paid the highest salary is what I joined. There was a company which came afterwards, but that didn't pay as much as this company did. And I stuck to that company for a long time, but I changed a lot of departments, a lot of roles, and finally ended up in a research role. And there are many schools which don't require a master's for you to do a PhD. And if you can do a fast track, you can finish your master's credit requirements within a year or so and continue with your PhD. So if you're trying to take a break, that is after your bachelor's work or after your master's also work, then you should take up a job which actually will help you in your PhD later. It's not like you do a software engineering type of job here and then you want to go and do a VLSI chip design type of PhD later. Then it'll be of no use.
Actually, I'm adding to the point. So actually, what you suggested, like doing masters, going to the industry for some years, and going back to the PhD. So I completed my masters last year, and then I've joined Microsoft, and I have exactly the plans that you see. And I would say that it gives you a completely different point of view. So when I was doing my masters, I was completely focused on my problem area. What I had a very narrow point of view. But I've been in the industry for less than 6 months, and it has completely opened up, you know, it opens up your mind to different areas inside your area of interest. So I would definitely rather recommend.
So I did not have any prior job experience. So if in your case you already have experience, so maybe you can just do 1 year, but always go to a related company. So.
Actually, I'm a professor. Is that okay, or only students have to? Okay, fine. I'm Professor Swarnalata Rao. I have got more than 3.5 years of academic experience. Long number of years at Indian Institute of Science, from where I received my degree and worked also there, and then thereafter moved to engineering colleges. I would like to just answer, this is as an answer to one of the questions which was asked. One girl was asking, when I finished my PhD and come, you know, from abroad, and I want to get based in India, which is a good place and how to find a good place in academics for continuing my research work. How to find. Now, for example, I'm talking about Karnataka here. We have an excellent university called Visheshwara Technological University, under which colleges are there. In fact, I worked for BMS College of Engineering for about 15 years, and then recently MBG College of Engineering, just retired as a postgraduate professor and just retired. I just want to tell you that excellent opportunities for carrying out research are there in these colleges. You can go to the university website, which gives you the addresses, etc., of all the engineering colleges, and also some rating of the colleges also you can find. And today, research centers are there in colleges where a lot of facilities are there for research. Like, the colleges are subscribing quite a lot, lakhs of rupees they subscribe for getting digital facility. All the IEEE transactions, etc., anything what I used to see in IASC library, now today those things are available here in the colleges. And secondly, research funding. Say AICT and some of them mentioned, the panelists mentioned, organizations like Department of Science and Technology and DRDO organizations. You can interact with DRDO organizations. In fact, some of my M.Tech students did excellent projects in DRDO organizations and things like that. So you have tremendous amount of facility to carry out your research work and also push yourself forward and tell the management that this is what you want to do. And I know places where lot of facilities have been given to researchers who wanted to do research, and some excellent research groups are there in some of these colleges. So there is no problem at all. Of course, like they said, IITs, IASC, all these things are there. But you have very good engineering colleges also, where you can be a leader. In fact, in those places, you can yourself set trends and be leader in what you want to do. And funded projects you get from AACT and so on. Secondly, some people asked for presenting papers in conferences. If you are a PhD student, if you are registered for your PhD, and you are a faculty member, and you show this proof that you have registered for PhD and your paper is accepted, even AACT will give you grants to go and present papers.
Thank you.
Thanks for giving the opportunity.
I have a question. So, let's say you are decided that you want to do a PhD. You have made a list of 15 professors who are top in the field. So how do you go about choosing, narrowing down your, I won't say options, of course, the advisor has to accept you, but what things should you keep in mind before, you know, even contacting the professors?
I think, again, I have to say it depends. Usually younger faculty are more ambitious and more active, more involved with their students. Maybe you should look for the professor's area of interest, the number of students this person has graduated. Talk to the students if possible in an informal setting. Try to find out if, you know, this is a person suitable for you to do your PhD with, because there are many different styles of advising and so on. It depends. I mean, I never did this. I just knew that I wanted to do databases, and in IASC there was one database person. I went to him. I did it. So
what if you want to do it in US or Europe? So you cannot go to US and talk.
You can correspond by mail, definitely. you can talk to the students through mail, ask them what kind of things that they're working on and so on. Obviously, no one is going to say that their advisor is bad and, you know, never join in your lifetime, things like that. But just to get a feel of things, this is probably something you can try. Students answer, professors, I'm not sure. They would.
And I just like to add that it really doesn't matter, because suppose you're in India and you're sending email to some professor in the US who you don't know what sort of guy he is, right? So your style might not match his. But in I don't know about Indian universities, but in the US it's very easy to go there. If you don't like one guy as your advisor, you can shift your advisors, especially in computer science where the funding is relatively high. So most professors in reasonably well-ranked universities will have funding. So it should be easy to switch to somebody who has a style and interests that fit you better.
Hi, my name is...
I'll just want to add to... Maya already said that you should look at a slightly junior professor because the person will be ambitious. That's because of their tenure requirement, that they have to publish so many papers and do so much research. But they usually don't have that much of funding. The people who have funding in the US universities, who have ample funding, are slightly senior professors. So I don't think, like Ranjita said, you should be so particular about it. But you had a question on Europe also. In Europe, it is actually very much dependent on the professor or the department. And the departments are very small, because the universities as such are very small. So you will just have one or two, or maximum three people in that area. And they will post their PhD student requirement directly on the website. So if you have to send your resume, and they have a admission process throughout the year. It's not fixed. Even Australia, some universities are like that.
I have just last question.
I'd like to answer to her.
Okay, sure.
I did my master's in the US, but I left it midway. I'm still, as in this summer, the last year I've taken as a sabbatical year to sort of figure out what I want to do. And it also matters, the person you choose, the personality also matters. It's like, one, for example, do they give credit to their students? Do they list their students on their web page? Do they, and writing to the students and finding out what kind. Frequently, it will be that they won't say anything bad about the professor, but you will at least get a feeling. You'll be able to gauge what kind of person the professor is, and that matters a lot. Although you can change professors or advisors once you're in the U.S., it might be sometimes it might not work out really well, and the advisor might hold a grudge and things might get a little difficult.
Yeah. Okay, so
long time, yeah.
Pretty good discussion. I'm really enjoying it. Myself, Pratibha. I'm from Samsung Electronics. My question is more towards, you know, some of the current facts related to, you know, the top talent crunch in the research domain at present in India. And as you just stated that we have only 40 at the most PhDs coming from India, as opposed to 3,000 plus coming from China. So, you know, my question is more towards, you know, how do you increase the intake? Because we have so many people sitting in second tier, third tier cities who may not be lucky enough to go abroad to do PhD. We were lucky. We could go to US, do PhD, do masters from IIT, ISC. But then, you know, we cannot deny the fact that there's so much of talent pool available in small cities because of the family problems or other stuff, you know, they are not able to get into research. So what kind of possibilities, solutions do you see wherein, you know, you can imagine a kind of a service where you can help people to do research from home, that kind of a thing, or training them for PhD, doing their PhDs? Do you see that some kind of services on that, where you can remotely guide people, can help India?
This is not something I have thought about deeply, so I don't have any answer to this question. I can only talk about the fact that I have a lot of students right now, enough that I cannot take even one more. I think I'm at my limit. So I don't know. The government has to take a role. I mean, education starts really young age. How to encourage people, how to set up the infrastructure. It seems to require a pretty large scale spending and infrastructure development.
I'll just like to add to what she said regarding the intake of PhDs. The government has actually increased the number of PhD intake in IITs and IIMs 2 or 3 years back just for this. And there are many other private universities and colleges also who have increased their intake. And our professor just mentioned, the connectivity to all these international publications, journals and all has been provided by the HRD Department of India to encourage this. But having said all this, your question of being able to do research or like work from home, research from home, I don't think research can be done in a solitary state. You need to build that network, have access to people. It's not just about having access to through your laptop or computer to a paper. You need to have access to people and be able to interact and discuss things with them. So being able to do research from home, I don't think that's going to happen immediately, given the fact that those people have not yet come out of their areas and explored the world. But about intake of PhDs, they definitely have increased the number of PhDs. But sadly, there are not enough students who have taken it up. Like when I joined IIM, I just joined in May to do my PhD program. There were 40 students intake, which IIM will do, but only 23 got through and only 20 actually joined. So that is the state. So I think the focus is more on doing your primary and higher education, because that is where right now India needs more focus.
Hello. Hi, I'm Preethi. I'm doing my PhD from IISc. And so one question is for Maya. So when you are a professor at IIT Delhi, so how much of your time does it take to write proposals and get your funding and all that? Because you need a lot of funding for, because you are a professor. If you are an MSR, you wouldn't really worry about all that thing. So that is one question. Another question is, so I totally agree with you, you have a lot of more opportunities in US. I know my friends have a lot of more exposure, they can talk to lot of more professors, and versus me where I am in India. And but then if somebody is interested in academics, somebody is interested in teaching, somebody wants to come back from US, but then we also need, then they need good students, right? But if all the good students are going abroad, then there's like dearth of good students for the professors.
Okay, so the first part, I've been at IIT Delhi for like 9 months now, and I so far haven't had the time to write even one decent proposal. So this might be just my fault because
I
haven't...
How about an indecent proposal? Sorry.
I don't do shoddy work, so there are no indecent proposals in mine. So... I think the amount of time I spend on teaching, that's quite significant, because, and this is the first time I'm teaching, so I have to prepare the classes, the content, manage the students. This is a new thing, and then I have to guide students in their projects, final year projects, so I have to think of interesting problems for them to solve, which is also useful for me in my research. And funding, I'm just kind of using the department resources right now, but I really feel that I need my own machines. So I'm planning to write a proposal, but haven't yet got around to it. So hopefully next semester is going to be better. Time management, it's really crucial, which I haven't been able to master yet. That said, I think right now I aim for about 10 hours of day work. So about 7 hours in the office, and then again 3 to 4 hours back at home. That's what I aim at least in the weekdays. So this is the minimum amount of work you need to actually stay in place. Forget about moving forward. So it's quite heavy. And the second thing that you said, what if everybody goes to US, who's left in India? I think the decision of whether to do a PhD in US or India, it should be taken at the personal level. Okay? Think of what's best for you and do that. Not what's best for India. I mean, it doesn't work that way.
So the other thing I'd like to add to that is what we said, at least what I said earlier about trying to do your PhD abroad in the US if you can, was driven by the current situation in India. But we have lots of professors who are joining who have exposure in other universities abroad, and they're bringing that culture and that style of research to India. So I'm hoping that in the next few years we'll see a shift, and I won't be answering that question the same way in a few years from now.
But think of yourself first.
Yeah.
If you're happy, then you know people around you are happy, and then society is happy. That way, don't think that India is going to, you know, miss students if everybody goes abroad. Think of what's best for you. Be selfish. Everything else works out after that.
Okay, so we just have time for one question. So, any one of you?
I have a very basic question. I did my master's. Now I'm working in an industry. But I did my master's in hardware background. Now, by working in the industry, now I'm looking at different areas, which seems interesting to me. How to decide upon an area, like what is the initial background work that I need to do? That is one question. And next question is, can you explain a little bit about what is the procedure to go outside US and do PhD there, and what are the opportunities?
Opportunities in India to do PhD?
Like
to go to the US?
US as well as in India. How
to go about it?
So I think we should take that question has a very long answer, so we can talk about that later. But about your first question, like I said earlier, it's about having a finger on the pulse of the areas that you're interested in. So it's like go to the conference proceedings, look at what the papers are. If you are interested in applied fields, which you might be given your background, take a look at what startups are doing right now. There's a website called TechCrunch. There are multiple websites which tell you what the startup industry, startup part of the world is doing. So you can get a handle, and the more research you do by browsing online and looking at conference proceedings, the better your judgment will be.
So I think it was great talking to all of you, panelists and audience. So I hope all of you would have got a lot of awareness on how to proceed and go about with your next plans. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks.